Good evening. Welcome to The Other Side with me, Costa. Once it's always a pleasure to be back in your homes and on your screens, even if you're watching us on the go via the Airtel TV app as well as Facebook, Diamond TV Zambia, every Sunday on DStv's 271, TopStar 110, as well as GOtv on channel 99. Thank you so much to Chimweka for sitting in for me last week. And I must say that I was on the copper belt, gathering a lot of interesting insights, having lots of interesting conversations, and so many interesting people who said they want to have a chat and sit on this particular platform. And we promise that we'll be coming through to the Copper Belt, and in season four, we'll exclusively make The Other Side one of the Copper Belt edition. Tonight, before I introduce my guest on the show, let's quickly get into the thoughts of the week. And this one comes from Mark Twain, and he says, "All you need in this life is ignorance and confidence. Then success is sure." I'll read it again. "All you need in this life is ignorance and confidence. And then success is sure." Laston Coleman says, "Luck is what you have left over after you give 100%. In short, you might give in all your effort, but at a moment, everything just doesn't happen there. You may need just a little bit of luck, or sometimes divine intervention, to get you over what your personal efforts may be." Welcome to it. My guest on the program this evening is an accomplished legal, practitioner. He holds a position of state counsel. He's served this country at the position of Solicitor General as well as Attorney General, once serving at the helm of the Law Association of Zambia's president, a father, a family man. But yet, we delve into finding out more about his other side. My guest is Musa, Mwenye, State Council. Good evening and welcome to the program.
Evening, and thank you so much for having me.
Interestingly, that we sit to talk. We've been chatting for so many years now on politics, legal matters, and issues of national importance. But today, we seriously just want to look into the other side of your life. And let's begin from something I just learned a few minutes ago. You've made a decision. Is it deliberate, or what is the rationale behind to simply tone down and throw away suits? What's with that?
I don't go to court as much as I used to in the early part of my career. Mm. So, and then for some reason I've developed a discomfort with ties and suits, mm-hmm. and maybe my forays into West Africa. Mm-hmm. have also impacted me, because their traditional dress is loose-fitting. Mm-hmm. And so I have more loose-fitting attire now when I'm not in court. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that has informed my more casual dress. Mm-hmm. I dress more casually these days when I can. Yeah.
Obviously, coming from the background of a lawyer, you're fixated on a dress code,
right?
What you should wear before the Supreme Court, the dress, tie, or the High Court, and so on. And that is embedded in, obviously, even from just university. As a practice of being taken seriously, mm-hmm. Are people still taking you that serious if you walked into the law firm like that?
Yes, I think they are, because I would hope that my substance goes far beyond,
it's far beyond my dress.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think the issue also, it goes a bit far beyond that. And if we are to be philosophical, these things we wear mm-hmm. are slightly foreign. Mm-hmm. And so I find myself a bit more comfortable with the things I consider traditional wear. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, we need to maybe identify what we consider to be Zambian traditional mm-hmm. wear. But the West Africans have their traditional wear. Mm-hmm. And I gravitate towards it a bit more. The more casual outlook.
Yeah. Well, I must attest that when that was being discussed in terms of what the dress code is, maybe some of us overdo it or whatever. Somebody was telling me the other day, how can you as a CEO wear sneakers mm-hmm. on a suit, mm-hmm. you know, to the office, or sometimes unethically so in the public perception? I've worn a suit with shorts on a lighter program and people find it offensive. What conforms your fashion sense? What inspires you apart from the West African style? I mean, this is a nice Fabiano shirt.
Yeah, I don't really have any particular dress sense.
Or the wife helps?
The wife helps, but also it's the sense of occasion. Mm. I wouldn't wear this at court. So the occasion Mm-mm. will inform what I would wear. Mm. But as I said, when I'm not in a super formal setting or court setting, I will rarely be in a tie. Mm-hmm. So I could dress like yourself, for example, be smart casual, but most times, comfort. I just want to be comfortable these days in my clothes. Mm.
Yeah. How does your fashion sense appeal? You've got older kids now.
And yes.
To keep relevance, sometimes they say, Dad, you don't look cool. That's old.
I'll let you in on a little secret. I started my career slightly young. Mm. And then I became honorary secretary of the law association when I was only 32 and dealing with presidents and so on. By the time I was 36, I was state counsel. Mm. I was solicitor general later on, and I had been last president. Mm. And then I ended up becoming attorney general by the time I was 40. Now, there is a sense in which hard work within that period leads you to a bit of a quasi midlife crisis.
Yeah.
And my children recognized it. They said to me, I think, Dad, you're having a midlife crisis. Let's go for shopping. And they bought me Timberlands, which I still wear up to this day. So over the weekends, it's not
you missed your period to wear the Timberlands.
I did. I missed it. Mm-hmm. I got married when I must have been. I started a family when I was 23 or 24. Mm. And skipped the stage when professionals become irresponsible. Mm. That led to the Timberland.
So do you wear those Timberlands with those caps?
No. I've never worn caps. I'm not a cap person.
Yeah.
In any case, they don't look nice on me. So I don't. But when I'm on the farm or building projects, it's not uncommon to see me in Timberlands. Mm. Yeah.
Interestingly so. Yeah. Now that you've brought up that aspect of missing certain stages in life, let's go back a bit to talk about your upbringing and your growing up. What type of family defines you? Did you always have, because people look at lawyers now, you own your own law firm with your name to it, and you've got all these accomplishments at a young age. It's like everything was smooth sailing. It's a golden spoon in your mouth.
No, far from it. Mm. I grew up in an era where, even with the humble education, my mom didn't have tertiary qualifications. She was straight from school, got into State Insurance Corporation, those days Zambia State Insurance Corporation, and rose through the ranks. And even with that humble education, those days during the Kaunda era, they were able to be given flats. So I grew up in a reasonably good neighborhood, but we didn't have a color TV. My mom died without ever owning a vehicle. Mm. And so it was hand to mouth. I remember to supplement her income, she would have one or two dryers in the dining room. That was usual those days. Mm. And then send someone to sell scones at the gate, and that's how we survived. And unfortunately, she died when I hadn't yet completed my grade 12. I went to live with an uncle who also...
That was here in Lusaka?
Here in Lusaka. Mm. And then I went to live, that's how I picked up my bemba. I went to live with an uncle in Chingola, where...
What a place to pick up bemba.
Absolutely. And as usual, with that part of the country, those days you learn the insults first. So I picked up the bemba there, but my uncle also died 2 years later. Mm-hmm. And that was about the time I was going to university. And from that time, apart from friends who helped me from time to time and lived with them, I grew up. I haven't had a guardian since I was 18 or 19 years old.
What did that teach you?
It taught me discipline, but also it taught me perseverance. I was in South Africa a week or two ago, and I said to someone, I told them the story that the first time I ever drove a car is when I was 19 on South African roads. I went there to buy sweets, to import sweets to sell in Zambia. And I got on a bus. No, none of my family members knew where I was. Wow. I just got on a bus and went to import sweets and stayed in Hillbrow, at the Hillbrow Inn. Have you ever been to
Hillbrow? Not at all.
Very rough neighborhood. And there's Pretoria Street there. I remember walking down Pretoria Street with a 20 rand note in my white shirt.
And it was showing.
It was showing. A very kind shop owner of Asian origin told me, young man, if you want to die over 20 rands, continue
walking
like that. And I met someone who used to live with my grandfather in Chilenge South. Long time ago. My grandfather had since retired and receded to the village. He met me on the bus going there and took my hand. We shared the room in the Hillbrow Inn, and he was importing a Datsun 120Y. He got on the road, drove. He was quite heavy, heavier than me, believe it or not. So he was driving, we were driving to Messina. And on the highway, he got so tired, parked on the curb, and gave me a 15-minute crash course in driving. And then got me to take the wheel, changed the gears to gear four, and said, drive, I need to sleep. And he slept. That was my first driving experience on the way from Joburg to Messina. So my upbringing was interesting, lots of adventure. But it taught me how to fight. To fight for my livelihood, to fight for the things I believe in, but also to persevere, even in times of hardship.
Part of the story you tell also brings out the aspect of Ubuntu that we talk about in Africa. People who are not your relatives or just take you in, your uncle, and so on. We see a lot of that quickly diminishing in our Zambian setup. Is that a healthy thing?
No, it's not. We have had a lot of community values as people, and family has been everything to our Zambian culture. But what is happening now is we have a lot of individualism coming in and tendencies that I think are not very helpful. Yes, there are aspects of our culture that are not helpful. But I think by and large, we need to rekindle the Zambianness that we knew. I mean, growing up, some of us, there was no distinction as to who will slap you for misbehaving. An auntie will just find you and discipline you. The neighbor from two doors away will discipline you. But they also took responsibility for you when they needed to. Our parents, obviously, you can't do that now because of diseases and so on. But when we were growing up, if there were two mothers breastfeeding in the family, any of the babies would breastfeed from anyone. And that is how deep our Ubuntu was those days. Because if my mom went away and my younger brother was needed to be put at the breast, my aunties would just put them at the breast and without a thought of it. So I think we need to go back to those values, to helping each other, inspiring each other, and most importantly, to mentoring young people.
Let's talk about the background of your law, career. Was it always, the plan, going to school as a young person? What did you aspire to be? And interestingly, you talk about Chingola as well in Lusaka. In those days, there was different influences. You had so many great footballers that could have influenced you. Music, Congo was nearby there and so on.
Right.
Was law the ultimate plan?
There used to be, I'm not sure that you would remember this, but in the late 70s, early 80s, there was a program on TV with a lawyer who always used to be building his house. He never finished that house. It was called Petrocelli.
I remember that program.
Petrocelli. And then later on, there was a program called LA Law. Mm-hmm. I watched those two, and from the time I was in grade 7, I knew I wanted to be a lawyer. So I'm one of those people who always knew what I wanted to do, except for a brief period when I stayed with my uncle, firstly in Ndola, and then later in Chingola. He was an accountant. So for the period that I stayed with him, a year or so, I nursed the idea of maybe I could be an accountant. But by and large, I've always been certain I wanted to study.
So when you watched these programs and that stuck on you, mm-hmm. there's always this gap of, this is what I want to be. Mm-hmm. But there are a lot of societal factors.
Right.
Sometimes you parents cannot afford to pay for your course, or you don't get the marks, or something along the way comes. So how do you get to build to really say, I really knew what I wanted to be, and I became it?
Right. Fortunately for me, myself and my siblings, particularly my brother, we were very academically talented. Mm. So I got to university. Those days, I think the total, we just had CBU and UNSA, which CBU was before, I think it was ZIT. Yeah, before. But then the humanities course didn't accommodate more than 1,200 students, if I can remember. The whole university intake didn't take 1,200 per year. And of those 1,200, if I'm not mistaken, there were about 300 to 500 in the humanities course. And law used to only take 30 maximum.
Wow.
So the sieving process was very rigorous. I think we would have been over 20,000 that wrote, and then you sieve, and then you go to law. And I managed to get into law school. And we had a bursary that worked. They used to buy us books. My first spectacles were bought by the government. Mm. So fortunately for those of us who grew up in that era, we had free education and we were helped through school, as long as you were talented.
How was University of Zambia then in terms of, I mean, most of the people talk about things the way you talk about them then, free this and so. Did you still have lumpens there then?
Oh yes, crazy. We had. Some of them are very distinguished members of society.
want to make sure.
No. But we had lumpens then. It was very nice. Obviously, the people that came before us enjoyed even more. Mm. But we were given an UNSA blanket. The richer kids would have duvets. We would have our UNSA blankets. We would have a bucket. We'd be given a bucket to use to bath. But the first thing we used that bucket for with our friends, because we had this sudden freedom, was to walk to Karingaringa and get a bucket of chibuku. So those buckets were first used generally for chibuku. Uh-huh. And then after that, you start using them
for bathing.
So we would, it was very nice. We had people cleaning our rooms. Mm. And they would not only clean the surroundings, but you were entitled to someone sweep your room and mop in those days. And we had good facilities, although the library was 3 or 4 years behind. Mm. 3 or 4 years behind. But otherwise, the facilities were reasonably good. Mm. Yeah, but it was fun as well. Yeah.
UNSA has produced quite a couple of people, yourself, the Levy Mwanawa, says HH, so on. Who are some of the characters you met in your time?
The former last president, meeting a lot. We met a lot. But I can claim to have been classmates with people like James Banda, who was last president. There's Judge Jones Chinyama in the Supreme Court. Mm. There's about 8 or 9 High Court judges who were in my intake. So we had a very high, I think one of the highest numbers of judges produced came from my class in recent memory. So a number of people that we interacted with.
Before we take a break, I want to go back to that story of sweets in South Africa. Was that an entrepreneurial period?
Yes.
What led to this disappearance of going to Joburg, and it puzzles me. Sweets?
Yes, sweets, because
we didn't have sweets in Zambia then?
Yeah, we didn't have. We had to import. No one was manufacturing them. Mm. And we used to have these quick shops at, they were not called quick shops then, but they were shops at feeding stations. So I got an order from a friend of who had a brother who was running one in China. Mm. And he says, we can't find these sweets in Zambia. If you can bring them, I'll buy them. And I jumped on a bus to go and get that. At one point, the second trip I went, I traveled to Chingola and went to Chingola Municipal Council then and asked them for an order, mm. anything. They showed me old computers. They were typewriters, really. Mm. And said, if you can get these diskettes, we'll buy them. And they gave me an order without any due diligence. No phone calls.
Was there a company that was set up?
They were, and they told me where they had previously got them.
No, but did you have a company for you?
No. Nothing. We would use friends' companies and so on. So I got on a bus and went to South Africa to order those. And I had a general idea where the company was, which was supplying. Walked in, told them that I've got this order. And that was one of my most painful business experiences because they told me, we phased out these things.
Oh my God.
And we threw out the last ones last week in the bin behind.
Oh.
I went into the bin to check and they had emptied the bin. So I ended up buying a few clothes here to sell. Lusaka Town Center there wasn't the way it is now. Mm. Behind them, Mflira Wandra support clubs and Kana Red Devils support clubs. They used to sell some clothes there. Mm. That's where I went to offload my cargo. So that was my second trip. But I also had a sewing machine. Mm. And then I ran a barber shop for a short period of time at Simoso.
So that entrepreneurial spirit was to sustain?
Sustain myself.
Despite having free education?
Yes, sustain myself. Because still, you know, my uncle died. And then my brother went to DK. Mm. And my sister briefly ended up in the village. Mm. And I had to support them somehow.
Yeah.
So sometimes I would have to walk all the way from Unza through this marsh. There was a marshland behind where you have the sports complex now. And arcades, those areas, East Park, that whole place was marsh. We used to walk behind there, and then I would walk all the way to DK to take him some supplies and walk back to school. So I needed that to help support my brother and sister, who have both done brilliantly well. My sister runs her own business in Perth, Australia. My brother is a finance director in Melbourne, Australia.
Wonderful. We're talking to State Councilor Musa Mwenye and obviously finding out a brief background about how it all started. After the break, we jump straight into the law experiences and obviously going into the future. What are the thoughts? What is on his bucket list? We'll be right back shortly. You're watching The Other Side with me, Costa. Thank you for still staying with us. And just in case you're joining us, you're watching The Other Side. My guest, State Councilor Musa Mwenye. Before the break, we're discussing his background and where it all started. And what has formulated part of his character into being the man and the person he is today. So let's talk now about finishing, university. And obviously, you had to undergo the famous Ziale that has now become the nightmare of every lawyer. How was Ziale back in your days?
Well, Ziale was still tough then. Mm. We had 33, well, the failure rate wasn't maybe as high as it is now, but we had 33 in our class. Three were repeaters and only 11 of us made it the first time. Mm. Yeah, so it was tough even then. Mm. Yeah, but I think... and I'll put my head on the chopping block, the quality of our education then may have been a bit higher because we had few universities, maybe there was better funding and so on. The mortality rate, if I put it loosely at the other now, from my experience in government and also when we were writing then the current university, higher educational bill, I think, which regulates universities, is the fact that the quality of universities mushrooming everywhere has, the quality of education has gone down because of the mushrooming of universities without the requirements of universities. So Ziyade was tough, but it was a good experience for us then.
Some complain, really, that education should be about gaining knowledge. It should not be torture or punishment. As a practitioner yourself, should Ziyale really be that thorough? Like, I mean, it's get it from me as a news person now, Ziyale results are like a lead story. Everybody is looking out to who cleared and who didn't. Which is not the case with any university and any other course, even medicine.
But it's like that. I'm admitted as a solicitor in England. Mm. And I went there when I was I'd already practiced law, if I'm not mistaken, for a number of years in Zambia. So I actually went there with a bit of condescension that I know these things. Mm. I failed. I failed the first attempt. I failed. Mm. I had to write again. And got admitted as a solicitor there. So even there, the failure rates are there. Mm. But what we must do now is not lower the quality of our education to accommodate the number of people passing. What we should do is increase the quality of the people coming to Ziyade. Mm. Because I have marked scripts at Ziyade. Mm. I was an assessor because we had those days, we would have people, the lecturers marking, then they'll bring the scripts to an assessor to make sure that they were fair, to countermark. Mm. And that time I remember that the lecturer who had marked that paper, he was a very senior state counsel. He had written on a remark on the paper. He said, this person with this kind of quality can't be a lawyer. And gave a low mark. When I read that, I felt it was unfair. Mm. Until I read the paper and endorsed, I agree. Because at that point, my daughter could have been in primary school. She wrote better English than that person. So how do you pass such a person?
The question then, how do you find yourself into
that? Exactly. Mm. It's the quality of the universities. Because when we were going to university ourselves, we were only the sieving process, only the very best got into those things. Yeah. And you were assured that if a person was in law school, they deserved to be in law school. Mm. The question is it true now? And to be honest, I'm not quite certain that it's true.
Some feel it's an orchestrated cartel within the legal fraternity to keep others out.
We only have 1,000 qualified lawyers.
So that we get the good money.
No, for us as employers, I'm an employer. Mm. I've run my law firm for several years now. If there are more lawyers, the cost of hiring a lawyer goes down. Mm. Why would most of the people who are lecturing at Ziyade run their own law firm? And the more, even yourself, the more journalists you have in Zambia, the less Diamond TV will have to pay for them. Because
the cost of
hiring goes down. Mm. So there's no reason why there should be that orchestrated move to cut down the numbers.
Let's talk about your experience. You've practiced now for over two decades and you've given us that experience. What was the first experience like in court? I know when you're doing Ziyale, there's the attachments to the law firms and so on. But what are the highlights you look back? I mean, and especially being a young lawyer, fiery, you really want to go and...
We were driven and the first trial I had was before then Judge Tamula Kakusa, the late, may his soul rest in peace. And my witness was Honorable Margaret Manakatwe when she was Director General of the then Investment Center. And a former employee of the investment center has sued for wrongful dismissal. And she was my witness in court. And I remember that after we finished with our evidence, I was now cross-examining the person who sued. And the cross-examination question, one of them, was centered on one clause. And I asked the witness whether or not he could have resigned and if the clause applied to both parties. And the judge stopped the trial and said the whole case hinges on the answer to this question. Mm. That was my very first trial. So when I heard that answer, I knew that I had won. So it was quite good to win your very first trial. But for me, my memorable experience even comes, one of the others, before I became admitted to the bar, because I worked for the late Mainza Chona when I was just, before that I'd worked with the city council in Lusaka. But I worked for the late Mainza Chona, and he said something that rings in my ears to this day. In the course of interaction, one day he called me into his office and told me stories about the late Harry Mwanga Nkumbula, KK, and so on. And then he looked at me, because he never drank. Mm. And he was a very sober, wise man. He looked straight at me and told me, young man, I have observed you. I have watched you. And I can guarantee you, within 5 years of you becoming an advocate, I'll read about you in the paper. And that, to me, has always rung in my ears. Mm. It was a huge endorsement for me and a huge encouragement to get it from a man who is number one on the row of practitioners. You may not know this, but Mainza Chona was admitted in 1958 as a barrister. He was the very first practicing lawyer in this country.
Well, interesting.
Practitioner, yeah.
Interestingly so. Now, with that, let me ask you something out there, and interestingly so, to take your own thought. Is law and the practice of law a noble cause? Is it a calling? Or is it one of those careers that you advise to go into because it's better pay?
Yeah, I think it's a myth that law is better pay. I've seen much more.
Is it a myth?
It is a myth. It can be better paying if you apply yourself. I know some lawyers who haven't succeeded myself. Mm. Okay? I know some lawyers who are struggling. But law is a profession and a calling where if you apply yourself, you will succeed. Mm. You know? So it's about applying yourself. It's about distinguishing yourself. And then it's also about establishing a reputation. And that, to me, is what underpins the success in the profession. Mm. Some people think that it's magic. You just become a lawyer, then you succeed. No. Mm. Like anything else, like any other profession, you have to work hard. Mm. You have to apply yourself. If a young lawyer gets admitted today, who knows him as being a good lawyer? Mm. Which big corporation will invest huge amounts of money in him as a practitioner? So the point is, for people to trust you, to take their destinies into your hands, you have to have a track record.
Law in itself is far and wide in terms of the various specializations.
It's as wide as life.
Except, correct me if I'm wrong, but again, from a journalistic perspective, only those who take on mostly criminal or controversial, criminal, political, a few commercial cases, see the headlines, and those begin to build the names. Because today, if I'm going to write a story and give a profile, or he was part of the team that defended O.J. Simpson, or part of the team that did that, is this how it's supposed to be, that you only get celebrated for handling the big cases?
Well, you see, the goodness is other areas of law, they don't need media prominence. Okay, because it's not the mass market. A taxation lawyer, for example, people in that arena know the good taxation lawyers, because there are conferences they go to, there are networks that they belong to, and so on. So there's various ways in which to know who a good lawyer is. There are listings, there are so many areas in which you can see. So people in specialized areas, people who need specialized services, will know who the good lawyers are in that arena of law. And to be honest with you, I'm not very sure that the media does much to enhance the profile of a lawyer. No matter how much I advertise a barbershop, Costa, you only go to the barber you trust. And the same is true of law. You can advertise as much as you want. This is me being old-fashioned.
But with that, what you have said, so what is the role of a lawyer then? Because they say justice is for all, and the public, or certain, maybe we need to educate them from legal scholars, like practitioners like yourself. People find it difficult. Why should you, as a lawyer, be defending a person who has been charged for murder before, if they say justice is for all? I've seen people complaining, why should certain law firms seemingly defend criminals who are charged with corruption? It's the same lawyers.
No, I would not condemn a lawyer who represents a person charged with corruption. Because in law, we have what we call the cab rank rule. You don't refuse to represent people unless you have a conflict of interest, you would be professionally embarrassed, or you have privileged information that would be compromised. So it's only if you have been accused of murder wrongly that you appreciate being represented. There is the presumption of innocence, and lawyers must represent, because we have an adversarial system. We have prosecutors, we have people who defend accused persons, and we shouldn't deny those being prosecuted legal representation. It is their constitutional right. And we shouldn't condemn lawyers who represent accused persons, no matter the crime they are accused of. So for me, I think lawyers who represent, there's nothing wrong that they're doing.
Here's an interesting one. One of the favorite things I enjoyed in legal school was jurisprudence, the concept of either you're a naturalist, what's the other one? You believe in the natural sense of it, or you believe that people must be punished by law, or where you believe people must be self-reformed?
Right, whether you punish them or whether you reform, it's essentially the carrot or the stick.
The jurisprudential aspect of it. But where I'm going to is this. And I know you remind me of this. There's a case of where somebody appealed a judge's sentence in this country because the judge became emotional when he gave up.
Cried, yes.
He cried, and then they felt there was that conflict. How do your beliefs, for example, we're very strong about Christianism, and how do your beliefs conflict your ability to do your job? If a client came and says, look, I admit that I killed somebody, but I need you to defend me, maybe to get a lesser sentence. How easy is that to perform? So for example, this is clear first degree murder. But you want to reduce it maybe to something like manslaughter or something like that?
No, I mean, our job is not to conjure up facts, to create facts that favor. That is clearly unprofessional conduct. But we have a duty to represent a client. And you know, a lawyer can actually go to court and help the client plead guilty. So there's a difference between defending and representing. I can go to court, sit there and with a client, and all I'm doing is telling the prosecutors, do your job. Because it's an adversarial system. You have the prosecutors and the defense counsel. They have to do their job. Okay, so everyone is entitled to representation. Whether that representation is defending that person, presenting facts that show that he's innocent, is a different issue altogether. So you can represent without defending. but you can also defend. So it depends on the facts. But what I do know is that most lawyers do not create facts. They listen. I'll give you an example. When I was a young lawyer, I was doing a legal aid case. We used to have pro bono legal aid cases through LADS. They would give you cases, be paid very little. It was a donor-funded program, but they wanted to decongest prisons and expedite prosecution. So we took those things up. And one of the people I was supposed to represent was a gentleman who was at Lusaka Central Prison, which is we call it Chimboka. Okay. Yeah. So I went to see this gentleman. He was remanded there, and I got his story. He was accused of having murdered his wife and his 1-month-old daughter. Now, I got to questioning him. I said, so what happened? Tell me what happened. He says, no, I was just accused. She was killed by someone else, and I just found them dead. And then I said, but where were you? He says, I was on the copper belt. I said, okay, so what time did you start off from the copper belt? He says, 10 hours. What time did you get into Lusaka? He says, 12 hours. So I said, you've never been to the copper belt, have you? He says, no, I've never, to be honest. And then he told me the full story, the truth about how he came home drunk after being away from home for 3 days. And they had no bed. When they fought, he fell down on the floor because they used to sleep on the floor in Kanyama. And she was hitting him so hard that he just reached for anything near him and hit her. And lo and behold, he had gotten a hammer, and cracked her skull and killed his wife. Now, you can defend that person on manslaughter because he didn't intend it. Mm. But what he told me next is what convinced me to say, I think I'm too emotionally involved in the case. I can't represent you. And I handed over the file to another lawyer. Because he said he sat for 3 hours looking at the daughter crying and thinking to himself, I have killed the mother. I'm going to prison. She'll be a street kid. And then he got a string and strangled her.
Oh, shit.
And after that, I was too emotional. And I said, look, I can't represent you. So it shows you that I wouldn't go to extra lengths to just...
Or say, God, what ed it was, manslaughter. Yeah.
Because lawyers are also human beings. Mm-hmm. So my job was to give him proper representation. But because I was emotionally affected by that narration as a young lawyer, I stepped back and I said, I can't do this, this case. Yeah. Yeah.
As we conclude, you rightfully said, 10 to 3 person now and basically supervising the law firm. You're an avid reader, I believe, because that's a hallmark of a good, lawyer. What literature do you read of late, apart from cases and literally those Horsbury's law books?
Yeah, I have always read more non-law books than law books.
Mm, why is that?
Yeah, and for me, I believe that it makes for a very dull person, a person who only understands their profession. I think intelligence, and particularly social intelligence, entails that... I'm not a soccer fan, by the way. I am now reluctantly watching with friends, but... If you and I got into a discussion about soccer, I would say something about it because I take an interest. I will talk about wide topics, history, politics, developmental issues, economics. So I read widely. Yeah. So I read more wider issues than the law.
Yeah.
So I'm reading more political interest and... economic interest issues now than legal issues.
So you're one of those people with a book at every time?
Yes.
So what are you reading at the moment?
Always. How Nations Fail. Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful book about the development of nations. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you see, we don't ever have to reinvent the wheel. There is always a playbook about the success of nations. And that's why it's very easy to see from what is happening that we're going the wrong way and we're going to fail. Mm. Yeah, so it's always a wonderful thing to read wider interest than the law. But doesn't mean I don't read law. Mm. When I'm doing a case, when I'm attending to legal matters, I study the law, mm. but read other interests. For me, law is about studying. Mm. It's scholarly. But for leisurely reading, I read other things. Mm.
When you look at legal scholars, judges, and so on, who would you say would be the greatest person to learn from? Lord Denning would be a legend?
Lord Denning was legendary. Lord Denning was legendary. Most of us lawyers draw a lot of inspiration from him. And the reason why is that Lord Denning took a path that was always unpopular and unconventional, and it later became the norm. So the reason why he is a person who most of us are inspired by is the reason that he thought outside the box. Mm. Most times, with respect to legal matters, he would always take a view which the other judges would disagree. So he was a dissenter. He was a serial dissenter. He wrote dissenting judgments, but his dissenting judgments more often than not became the law later on. So, and he never drove a car. He was the last, one of the last fee simple judges. These are judges that served until they died. Yeah, but of course he had a few skirmishes. He was at one point accused of racist remarks and so on, and there was a big furore about him, but otherwise he was inspirational. But there are also lawyers who inspire, like Mandela, for example, because Mandela ran what was a thriving practice, which served a lot of the black folk in South Africa at the time he was practicing. He was a successful lawyer for his time, but he chose the interests of the people. He chose a life in prison for the sake of the people rather than personal gain. So it teaches the true virtues of law. Law is about justice. Law is about sacrifice. And some of us have seen that there are times that speaking, the things that we have said have cost us a lot of money. Mm. It would have been easier to make money by being complicit and compromising. But the cause of justice requires that at any pivotal moment, we speak truth to power. Mm. And I must speak for lawyers. I know there's a lot of discontentment about our profession at the moment. There's been accusations there. But I'll tell you one thing. There is no period in this country, no pivotal period, when there is need for people to stand up courageously, that there has been no lawyer to stand up for the people. Mm. And that is true from independence to now. There's always lawyers that put their necks on the chopping board and decide to speak courageously and to sacrifice their livelihoods and sometimes even put their lives at risk. So we are not that bad.
Others in your stage obviously would want to say they network using the golf course. Others would like to go hunting. Are you any of those? What do you love doing away from your office? I know you're big on family, but you're not a soccer fan, so are you to golf? Are you to hunting?
Well, I socialize. I like a good conversation. Mm. I go to the bush. Mm. Yeah, I don't hunt much, but I like the serenity of the bush. So I love rivers and waterfronts, and I'm fortunate to be able to go to some of these places and have a home or two and just relax and rest in by the water. I don't like being on the water, but I like being by the water. Mm. Yeah.
Music, what music are you listening to in the car?
Oh, I have wide interest. Mm. You'll be surprised. Mm. I listen
Chandelier
to all. No. That is going a bit too far.
You don't tolerate our noise.
But I listen to all sorts of music. Mm. Yeah, I listen to gospel music. I listen to Nigerian. What do they call it now? Afropop?
Niger.
Yes, Afropop. I'll listen to Ghanaian music, Mozambican music, and all sorts, pop, R&B, hip-hop. But I come from an era where R&B appealed to us. We were that generation that listened to proper music.
So that's where the bassness goes?
Yes, so the R&B music, anything that hinges on R&B, I'll listen to it. Yeah.
So who's your favorite R&B artist?
He's gone quiet, but I really like Craig David.
Craig David, wow.
Yeah.
From the UK.
Yes.
Interesting. And TV, apart from news and stuff like that, what do you delve into? Any documentaries?
A lot.
Movies?
A lot of documentaries. I love Netflix. There is a program which you should watch on Netflix if you haven't. It's a series. And one time I binge watched it really in 2 days. It's called How to Become a Dictator, I think.
I've seen it.
You've seen it.
It's got different. It's got Idi Amin, it's got Saddam, it's got Gaddafi.
Yeah. So they have fantastic programs on Netflix. But I also watch DStv, I watch ZNBC. And my brother once said to me, I was visiting him, and he looked at me and said, "For a very busy man, you watch too much TV." So I do watch TV quite a lot, yeah. But not football. Sometimes I do when I'm trying to be social with my friends, but I have no team I support. I'm being convinced to support Manchester United. What do you think?
What a wrong choice. what a wrong choice. You're better off being neutral. Even locally, no football team, not even in Changa Rangers or...
No. Changa maybe, Nkana Red Devils sometimes, but I'm a passive fan, let me put it that way.
Football can kill you, so...
Absolutely. I think what we must do is, you know, the problem is I became an ultra Pan-Africanist at one point. And that informed me several years ago. Obviously, I may not hold the same views I had, but I had a difficulty with someone who's never been to Manchester supporting Manchester United. When we have Nkana Red Devils. You remember there was a time when you would go to the... There were actually fan clubs.
Yes.
From Nkana Red Devils, Mfudira Wanderers, Power Dynamos, and all sorts of Lusaka Dynamos. So I think we need to get to the place where, as we support, there's nothing wrong with supporting foreign teams, we should also encourage people to support local teams.
Interesting. Yeah. Many Zambians are now supporting Leicester, so...
Well, yeah. I watched Leicester because of
Patson.
Of Patson, yeah.
Thank you so much, State Council, for talking to us and allowing us to delve into your other side. And we've learned quite a lot and interesting issues. That wraps up this week's edition of The Other Side. My guest, State Council Musa Mwenye, we've been delving into his other side and getting to find out more about the law and his life. Thank you so much. The news desk is up next at 8. We'll see you next week.